I'm no island, peninsula maybe. Makes no sense, I know crazy. Give up all this pussy cat that's in my lap. No looking back, spaceships don't come equipped with rear view mirrors. They dip as quick as they can. The atmosphere is now ripped. I'm so like a pill. Yeah. They say I walk like a king, talk like a king. You can act around now, say the same thing. They chasing the fame, they all want the name. But they ain't got what's running through these veins. Say I walk like a king, talk like a king. You can act around now, say the same thing. They chasing the fame, they all want the name. But they ain't got what's running through these veins. Make way for the king.
Welcome, welcome everyone to the Canceled Show. I'm your host, Rashad Dyson.
Yay, yay. What's up, everybody? And this is your boy, Manny.
Welcome, kings and queens, pawns and peasants, and everyone in between. Bienvenidos, mi gentes.
Yay, yay.
What a canceled show.
There you go.
Yes, sir.
Today we got a special one.
Yeah?
What? We got Big Dookie on the ones and twos.
Shout out to the homie Dukes.
Shout out to big homie Hakeem.
Hakeem.
Stepping through.
Y'all doing tonight, y'all?
Thanks, homie. Tell us a little about yourself, man. Where'd you go, you know?
I don't know how far y'all want me to go back.
Like, hey, anywhere you want.
Coming out the womb. Exactly. Well, it all started with. Nah, but I'm Hakeem. I go by Hakeem, from Kentucky, Lexington to be exact. I've been in Arlington for about 3 years now. My work brought me here. Currently a flight attendant now, so constantly traveling, day in, day and out. So every time I'm here, I get a chance to work out and hang out with some of my friends. And so that's kind of what I usually do on my days off. And
yeah.
I'm just honored to be on the show. I know you've asked me on several occasions to get on, and my schedule never coincided, but yeah. Now I'm here. I was able to squeeze it in, so I'm ready to get this thing going.
Appreciate you. And yeah. I remember for the longest time, because Manny met you first,
yeah.
And he would always brag about you. He's like, man, you got to meet Hakeem, man. You got to meet Hakeem, bro.
It's because like
y'all would hit it off, and then like as soon as we met, I was just like,
yeah, these guys are talking, bro.
Because I think it all started like, because you know me and Manny, we have that interest in martial arts.
Yeah,
mm-hmm. And I've always picked his brain, mm-hmm. about like, okay,
that's exactly how friendship started.
What do you
yeah.
think about this scene here, you man? Started. Last night I was watching this movie, and man, the fighting scene on this was dope, man. Have you seen this? And,
yeah.
And we started seeing each other clips, mm-hmm. of like fighting scenes and things of that nature, and mm-hmm. then it just went from there to just having more deep discussions about just life in general.
Yeah.
And then that's when he brought you up, and he's, mm-hmm. like, man, you know, you got to meet my boy Rashad, man. You and him, y'all think just alike. And mm-hmm. and it was just, when we first met, it was just bam.
We just jumped right into it,
man. I'm like, yeah, that's all right.
We
definitely have like minds, man. So that's cool.
Yeah, that's when I first met you. That's actually how I became friends with you. You were asking me about Wing Chun first, and then you started talking about like the fight scenes. I think which one would realistically work. Like, I think it was Ip Man, and then we talked about it. Undisputed. My boy, mm-hmm. shout out to the Scott Adkins, watching this.
Oh, yeah. Michael J. White.
Michael J. White.
Yeah, man. All those boys.
Yeah, you kept asking me, and I was like, well, I mean, some of it is, you know, again, I'm an actor myself. Some of it is just movie magic. You know, a lot of those techniques only look good on camera, but in real life, it doesn't work that way. It rarely works.
Or the way you want it. If those techniques do work, it doesn't look anywhere close to the way it does on camera.
Yeah.
It's... Like, I always say that real martial arts, like, when you get down to it, it looks ugly. Like, it does. It doesn't look pretty at all. It just...
Yeah.
So, it's effective.
But, right.
But it doesn't look pretty at all.
Yeah, I don't think it'll look as pretty like we see in the movies and stuff, you know. It's just... Nah. That's why I've always had the question. That's why I had to roll up to Manny, like, yo, Manny, can this actually...
And I would show him right in the middle of, like, the gym. I'm like, no, we'll throw a punch. And I'm like, we're going to see. This is how that would work. And, uh-huh. and we would just be talking martial arts. Mm-hmm. Hey, shout out to Sabera. She's watching. She said, Manny is amazing. This is a fact. But he likes cupcakes too much. No, that's Rashad. my boy Trent said, Rashad and Manny, what's up, brothers? What's up, my guy? Thank you for watching and tuning in. But yeah, that's how my boy Hakeem, we became friends. And then the way you spoke, it's because you spoke very intelligently. And every time you thought with you thought your thinking patterns were just like his. Mm-hmm. You guys have like similarities, and I was just like, man, you guys would be awesome. So I try to connect you guys for the longest.
Yeah, but you would always miss each other or something.
Yeah,
like that.
And I kept trying to have you on a couple of episodes. I think we tried to have you on the toxic episode.
Yeah, we did try to have you on that one. Yeah.
Was that the one where y'all talked about the
toxic women?
Yeah, and I think I dropped a comment on that.
Yes,
because I remember I told you guys that I dropped a little something with that, but. Yeah, I was actually out at a restaurant when y'all was live that night.
Yeah.
So I was kind of having the phone in my ear. I'm trying to listen in, but I'm like, all right, I'm about to put my 2 cents in.
What are you doing? Oh, they're talking about toxic bitches.
Exactly. hold on 1 second, baby girl.
right.
Hold on, baby girl. Let me write this comment right quick.
Yeah. No, for real.
About these toxic ass men. Excuse me?
No. Wait, are we splitting this?
Exactly. I'm not talking about you. Wait, are we splitting this?
No.
Talk about you.
you had some and that, again, that's what made me think of like you and Rashad, because sometimes you would bring me topics and talk about some topics that you would go through and about the nice guy finishing last and the whole alpha and beta and I mean, we see it first thing, you know what I mean? It's a bunch of bullshit, you know. So
it is, man.
And then I would go back and tell Rashad, like, man, my boy Akeem has some brilliant ideas, bro. And you know, Rashad, he'd be like, I don't care, you know.
No, I'd be like, man, he has some really smart ideas. Wait, why do I need Manny on the show again? Like, I think sometimes. Yeah, like,
I told him, I'm the talent bitch.
Are you though?
Yes.
All right, cool.
Yeah. So that's how we started. And eventually, I'm glad you came up here, man. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, thank you for coming.
Glad to be here. It's an honor to be here, man.
So flight attendants, man, how does that work? Like, do you ever get your days confused and mixed up?
Absolutely, because you're traveling constantly, you know, and you're different time zones, different cities throughout the day, and it's just easy to lose track of what day it is, and it's just, you know, we're constantly in the air, constantly traveling, and there's some pros and cons to it depending on how you look at it.
So you do those those red eye flights, those like overnight flights? You do those
too? We mean like overnight, like talking about like overseas type of
No, like the ones like overnight, like, you know, like 3-4 in the morning kind of flights.
Oh yeah,
like
yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And it differs each day. So for instance, like tomorrow I got a showtime at 6.
Damn.
And then the fall.
Calling showtime?
Yeah, 6 in the morning.
Okay.
Yeah. So, which means I got to get up early just to, you know, get prepared and then get to the airport. And then let's say the following day, we may start at like 2 in the afternoon. So it switches each day.
Right.
But typically, if your first trip of the day starts early, usually it kind of follows in that pattern. Mm. So. Yeah, but again, it has its pros and cons, you know, depending on how you look at it.
Yeah.
You know, one of the pros of it is that you get to travel.
Yeah.
You know, you get to go to all types of places.
Right.
You know, you meet new people. Mm-hmm. And then the downfall of it is you travel a lot.
Right.
And so, you know, in the terms of like, you know, I've missed out on several events and just invitations and stuff, especially. You know, it's difficult to create a social life if you're constantly traveling.
Right.
And that's one of the reasons why I'm not even dating right now, because, I mean, I just don't have
you
the time.
Got
I'm about to say, man, you got flight attendants, though. That's
in different area codes.
You're constantly surrounded by beautiful women. Code. Especially in different area codes. Right?
I'm just saying, you know.
Nah, I ain't working it like that. I wish I did.
Okay.
All right, I'm not trying to put your business out there.
Me neither.
My bad, bro.
I got you, bro. You don't get that like that.
That's right.
I got you.
Nah, baby, you're the only one in Memphis.
right.
You ain't the only one in Florida.
Exactly.
Looking good. Hey, Janella. Shout-outs to Janella. She said, looking good, Manny. Thank you. I'm getting a lot of compliments today.
Hold on.
Yeah, my man has been working out, man. So, I got to give him a shout-out, man, because when he first started working out with me, I gave him a week. I said, after a week, I'm not going to see this man no more.
Yeah,
but he's been the one that's been calling me up on my ass, like, are we training today? Thursday, add me another day. And a Thursday. We hit it leg day, then we did backs, biceps, and then cardio back on Sunday. So he's been keeping up, man. Shout out to my boy Rashad, man. He's been kicking ass, bro.
Consistency, man. That's where he's at.
That's the key, man.
Consistency. He's the best trainer I know.
Thanks, bro. Yeah. Where y'all work at? 24, our gym right here next to the parking lot. Damn, I didn't even know you work out, dude. Dude, you down?
What? Dude, I'm back. I'm down to work out.
Oh, okay, yeah. Hey, it's open invitation, brother. Bro, we could. This is the squad right here.
This is squad, bro.
Actually, fun story. Hey, people.
I know what you mean, man, by not wanting, you know, going to the gym by yourself, because usually that's all I always do.
Yeah.
But luckily enough that I'm able to make friends throughout the time I've been training at 24. That's how we met. Every time I roll in the gym, I always greet everyone that I know.
Yeah.
That's just like.
Dude, open invitations, Dookie. If you ever want to come out there, brother, you're more than.
Me anytime you're going.
All right. And not only me, you got two other guys right here now. You're not by yourself.
Message me anytime you're going to the gym.
Cool.
If I'm not doing anything, I'm there.
All right, let's do it. Let's do it. Yeah.
We hitting it up, hard on Monday, so.
Monday.
So
chest day. Shoulders.
Gosh, I be in the air, man. It's Monday.
Oh, yeah. Well,
I touch back down.
I do an extra set for you, bro. I do an extra set for the boys.
But actually, right, when I go show up to 24, I show up with the gang. I'm not going to lie to you. Right?
Yeah.
I always showed up with like five or six people I would have with me on a daily basis. Mm-hmm. And it was crazy. A lot of them are all my students.
Oh, man. Yeah.
I do really show up with the gang, though.
Y'all be killing it, though. And I'm taught you a few things.
You showed me some workouts that one of them is actually what that I'm scared to try, but it was the one where you squat down, you jump up, and you push the sled.
I remember you was wanting me to demonstrate it to you. I haven't had a chance to. We have to, get that arranged one day.
Because
I've only done it like once. That was like a year ago. Mm-hmm. So, but yeah, that's a good cardio workout.
I haven't.
Manny asked to see your form in slow motion.
No, it's because the way he does it, it's exhausting, bro.
That's the way he does it. Okay, I got you.
It's like he drops down on the ground and he explodes forward while pushing the sled.
But before you do that, you have to drag the sled to one end, and then afterwards you get down in a push-up position, pop back up like you're doing a burpee. Then you push the sled, and then you just kind of repeat that same sequence.
Oh, bro, like no. Yeah, when he did that. My boy over here, I'm not gonna lie to you. Was it Thursday? We did leg day, and it's called the Superman leg workout. Apparently, it's the one that Henry Cavill did for his leg day, and he did it, bro. When I said my legs were shaking,
oh my god,
it looks like I was twerking. No homo, but it looks like I was twerking because my legs were shaking so bad. Hey,
bro,
nice,
that's a good exercise, bro. Twerking.
Nice cup right there, my guy.
Oh yeah.
What does it say?
Shout out to Jenny from the block.
Shout out to Jenny.
Yes. Orphan Tears.
Orphan Tears.
Yes.
I don't know why he wanted that cup. So. It was your birthday gift.
It was my birthday gift.
Let me see again.
Yeah. So.
Orphan Tears.
Yeah. See, ask me like, what do you want?
Aww.
I'm one of those people where like it doesn't matter like how expensive something is. Like if someone gets me like a, Cartier watch or something like that, or a Hublot watch or something like that, To me, that doesn't mean as much as this mug. You know what I mean? Because it's like, it's something I wanted. She's like, okay, what do you want? I was like, I really want a mug that says Orphan Tears. I don't know why.
Really?
It's funny to me. You know what I mean?
Yeah. It was something specific that you
exactly. Wanted, something specific.
Twisted sense of humor, but,
Huh?
Orphan, I said, twisted sense of humor, but, it was Orphan Tears.
Yeah, exactly.
Fuck you, Rashad. Wait, shit. Hey, somebody. Oh, Sabero said, "Yes, amazing shifu and trainer. Wouldn't be where I'm at now if it wasn't for you, Manny. Oh, thank you so much. But I don't do nothing. It's all you guys. Remember, I can only show you the path, and you have to walk it.
That's facts.
Glad to have you walk that path with me, bro.
Hey, brothers, man. That's why we're here. We gotta encourage each other. That's why we're here, man. This is the whole point of the council show is that we talk shit, but we got your back.
Yep.
There you go.
But it's gonna be a forward move. And sometimes you don't like it, So what? We can disagree and keep on pushing.
Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah.
So we do have one more guest. We have El Padre returning. El Padre.
That's right.
So
Padre.
But Keem, how was your week, man?
Uh
I know I've seen you off and on, but tell the people how you.
It's been pretty decent, man. Just working, and I had 3 days off this week, so which is a good thing, because typically I'm usually off for like maybe 2 days or one, so three I could take that any day.
Right.
So didn't do anything major, man. Just kind of kick back, chilled all
day.
You
need that time.
Yeah.
You need that time.
And, and pretty much just rest up, man, and and just watched a lot of documentaries, man.
Like, oh yeah, you were telling me there was a documentary about Rome.
Yeah, Roman emperor, emperors. Yeah, on Netflix. I think it was like Rome Empire or something like that. And I've always been fascinated with Roman history, just you know, the stuff that they did back in that time, and yeah, I was just kind of sitting there watching just nothing but documentaries on the, you know, different types of emperors they had, and and yeah, I'm a geek like that at times, man. You know, I just kind of, you know, look for a topic, man, and I just kind of look it up, and I just binge watch documentaries, and so yeah, that's kind of what I've been doing this week, pretty much, man. So yeah, what about you, man? How you?
Well, this week has been this week has been interesting because like because I do construction, right? So
I didn't know that.
Yeah, yeah. So I do construction, and I'm literally just finishing up a project. So like we're in that like final touches stage, and I'm moving on to another project. And so I've been doing like these little like as I'm finishing up one project, like other projects have just been needing like one or two things, and so I've been like basically I've been putting out fires. Like basically it's just like, hey, we need somebody to come back here because the general contractor is needing us to pull this. He's needing us to get this out of his way. He's needing us to do that. So I've been going back and forth. So, you know, shout out to my project manager. He's really I've been kind of his go-to guy. You know what I mean? Because I've always been of the mindset that the best ability is availability. So if you're available to do stuff, you're usually in a better position to, you know, come up with something.
Makes you reliable and dependable. Exactly. So that's very that's very important, though, man. So what you mentioned that you've been working on a project. So what type of project that you're currently?
It was actually the Univision building in downtown Dallas.
Okay. So they didn't know they had a building.
Yeah, they got a building. It's like 28 stories. I don't know, it's huge, but shout out to the weather girls. I've seen them. I've seen seen a couple of them.
Nice señoritas.
Yeah, but anyway, so they got a nice staff up there. Really
I
nice.
I bet it's a really nice. Yeah, staff.
They're really nice, really personable. But anyway, so no, they were renovating a couple floors underneath their studio.
Okay.
So I was part of the project that was, I mean, they gutted the whole thing out. So I was there for that. And then, you know, they put in new offices, cubicles, stuff like that.
They're going all out with it.
Yeah, they all out.
So do you live here in Arlington, or are you like closer to Dallas?
Well, I moved to just moved to Dallas. I actually live in like downtown Dallas.
So you make the commute from, I know like when there's no traffic, you know, depending on which side of Arlington you're at, you get there like 30 minutes. But in broad daylight, you ain't getting it on 30 minutes.
Bro. Yeah. See, that was the thing is, you know, I used to live in Arlington because the thing is, I have a lot of family and friends in Fort Worth, and I have a lot of family and friends in Dallas. Mm. So I was like, well, I'm going to move to Arlington, and that'll be in between. But the problem is that Arlington has traffic of its own, which is horrible.
Oh, yeah.
So I'm hitting traffic all the time.
What the drivers just suck.
Yes. It's like Fort Worth drivers, they drive slow, but at least they'll get out your way. Mm. Dallas drivers just drive crazy.
Yeah.
And then people in Arlington are like a mix in between. They drive crazy and they drive slow. So it's like...
And I have to say this, since I moved here to Texas, since I'm no native here, and to be specific about Arlington, I find it interesting that there's no public transportation in the city of Arlington. That's crazy.
No, there isn't.
Yeah.
They got VIA or whatever.
They got like those little buses that go to like Walmart and stuff, but
pretty cheap.
They got Ubers, what they got.
What's up? Our returning guest, El Padre.
Padre.
Welcome.
Welcome back.
Love the hat. I'm feeling that hat, man.
This is my boy, Keem.
Yes.
This is El Padre.
El Padre. How you Keem. Doing, man? Welcome.
The Duke Meister.
What's up, Dookie?
El Padre brought me...
What do you think?
Orphan tears.
El Padre brought me a gift, but it won't fit me. I'm loving it, though.
What is the extra medium?
No, it's 3X. I'm like, I know I'm fat.
Oh, that's
no
dope.
Offense.
No offense.
But I know you're a 3X, right?
I'll wear it. I'll take it.
I love that.
I figured he could grow into it.
Yeah. No offense.
No offense.
You heard the story about that, right?
No. Y'all might have to feed me.
Oh,
man.
Oh.
Hello there.
Oh, yeah. You good, sir.
So in one of the stories, it's a story that happened to me at the gym with this old man Dino. He was saying some stuff, but he kept saying no offense. And actually, people, no offense. I'm like, it's sticking. I hate it already. No offense. And then they'll say something offensive. Actually, that's the running joke I think of. But you are a guy that would punch an old man in the face.
This old guy apparently ran out to him. And one of the first things he said was, you look like a guy who wouldn't punch an old man in the face. Let me ask you a couple questions. Yeah. And he would ask him some stuff, and like they would just be offensive. Like,
yeah.
You know what I mean? Like,
not to get the COVID because I'm fat.
Not to get COVID because it doesn't work on fat people since you're fat. No offense.
I'd be like, man, you taking a shot, man? It's like, clearly.
He kept saying, but you're not a guy that would hit an old man, would you? And Rochelle was like,
no.
But you are that guy that would hit
an old man. Yeah, like, that's your path.
I really am, though. I really. No, that's me now. Like, I have a short temper for stuff like that. But
Manny would punch an old man in the face.
And I'm surprised he didn't. I would brag about it.
You wouldn't feel bad about it at all.
But thank you so much, Pastor. Mm-hmm. Man, that story means a lot to me. But but if you want to give me a 2X, I wouldn't be mad either.
Hey, no offense.
No offense.
We can make that 2X happen.
Yeah. No.
How's your week?
We were talking about the week. How was your week, El Padre?
Man, it's been stressful, up and down.
Really?
Did apply at Amazon.
Oh,
because
yeah?
of the health benefits, so mm-hmm. I'm going ahead and doing that.
Okay.
That out of the culinary field. So switching fields, trying to do something different.
Really?
Okay.
Yeah. Kind of got tired of it, or just wanted to just try something different.
Oh, bro, you really haven't listened to our stories.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to need you to go back and start from...
There's some juicy stories.
Yes,
bro. And this good part, by the way, there is still part two coming to historic... Yes.
Was it High School Rangers?
Yeah, High School Rangers part 10, episode 10, and there is a part two to that.
Ooh,
When it's coming, we'll sit down and talk with you, El Padre. But you go back and listen to some of the last podcast, man.
Yes,
it's crazy. And you know what? Shout outs to people that have been hitting me up. And I was going to tell you about that. Yeah, people have been hitting me up and say, like, wow, that they somebody called me and said, I have that same exact thing happened to me, too.
Mm-hmm.
But the school covered it up.
Yeah.
See, and that was what was going on in Denton. Denton mm-hmm. ISD was trying mm-hmm. to cover it up, too, yeah. until all those kids came out and protested.
Yep.
If right. it wasn't for that... Denton ISD would have been covering it up.
100%.
Oh, yeah.
100%.
But, you know, again, you guys got to go episode 10?
I think it was episode 10.
Episode 10, High School Ragers. Check it out.
High School
Listen
Rangers.
To it, mm-hmm. and then come back and we'll talk some more.
Yeah.
But other than that, man.
Yeah, and High School Ragers, that's on all the platforms. That's on
any platform on YouTube, Spotify, yeah. Apple. By the way, I just found out we're on iTunes.
Mm-hmm.
So anywhere that's a platform, you can check it out.
Mm-hmm.
So you have no excuses.
That's right.
Akeem.
Exactly.
Out there with them sexy flight attendants. Share with... See, it's a conversation.
Too much distraction, man.
Yeah, it's a conversation starter. Like, you should check out my boy's podcast.
Exactly.
Okay.
I'm working on our card design.
Yes.
It's a secret. I'm going to surprise you.
I know that from what we talked, it was hilarious. I'm not going to, talk about it, but I know it was funny.
Yeah.
Every time we do something, I always say it's the council way,
Exactly.
It's the council way. So, it's going to be funny. It's going to be probably edgy. Mm-hmm. And most importantly, funny again.
Yeah.
So.
And raw and uncut.
Yeah. Exactly.
No, that's Eddie Murphy.
That's the thing. It's like, we don't do... I mean, we do the normal stuff. We don't do the normal stuff in the normal way.
Gotcha.
We just
gotcha.
Well, I mean,
because that wouldn't be us.
Yeah, there you go. I mean, the way everything's set up now, you have to be sensitive. You got to be careful with what you say. That and you know, everybody wants to be politically correct. Everybody wants to be on the no, I'm right and you're wrong. Oh, I can't agree with you. Oh, that's offensive. That you hurt my feelings, and I'm just like, I don't care. So
yeah,
that's how the show is. It's unapologetic. I mean, you can feel whatever you want. But you know, talking about that though, I was having me and my brother Rashad, we were having a discussion about interracial relationships.
What color got to do with got to do with the vocals? That's right.
So everybody has different opinions, and so far, mine's. Well, I'll give you mine's last. Where do you guys stand at, Rashad? Where do you stand on the real? Oh, you've dated a black chick before, right?
Yeah. I've dated black women before, so you know, I'm down with mixing stuff like that. So,
well, people don't know, Rashad. I think I met Rashad when he was, I think since I've known you, you never dated a black woman.
Except for my wife?
Yeah, that's the only one, though. Besides that, it's always been a different ethnicity. It's never been a same.
It's either been like a white or a Mexican. Well, no, I've dated a couple. They just never made it to you yet. it's kind of like there's like a video game, like there's different levels. They just hadn't got to the Manny boss level yet.
Yeah.
So, there you go.
If I get to meet you, you're pretty special. I'm about you guys. Apodji, where do you stand on the...
I've been all the colors of the rainbow.
Hey!
No discrimination.
What about you, Akeem?
I don't discriminate.
Don't discriminate.
I congratulate.
Okay, but is there a certain race that you would be like, nah, I don't date. I wouldn't date,
Nah, I've never been built that way.
No?
But
no.
I was going to say, but I think this is what brought the idea of this discussion, what I mentioned a few days ago at the gym, about people's reasons of wanting to date out of their race or a particular race.
Right.
And I wanted to make a distinction of why are certain people dating out of their race? What's the reason behind that? Is it because I know that people have preferences,
Right.
That's one thing, You like what you like. That's cool. Yeah. But, I think where some of the issues may be is when someone is not given a particular race a chance just because of their race and what the negative stereotypes is associated with that race is where I'm kind of like, man, no, I can't roll like that. And I've had friends that I know personally that are wired that way, and I've had major debates and discussions about this issue with some of my close friends. Not all of my friends that, but there's a couple of them. Yeah.
So what we're saying, they got prejudices against certain races.
Yeah.
We're just going to call it what it is.
I guess you can say it that way. I never really thought of it that way, but it's just... And the thing is, it don't make sense. Is that it's their own race? That's the thing.
What you mean?
Yeah, you can be prejudiced against your own race.
That's why you have like the character Uncle Ruckus from Boondocks. That's why that shit is real.
Reverse vitiligo.
But it's just like the reasons for it. It just doesn't make sense. It just doesn't. And just to generalize a particular race. And just be like, oh, well, especially when they talk about the black girl, black woman, rather. And, and some of my friends, they've always made this point, like, man, I can't mess with a black chick. They're ghetto, they're loud, this, that, yada, yada, yada,
Right.
And
you've never met a chola before.
No other girl, any other race does the same shit.
Right.
Yeah.
And one of my friends in particular, he and I are alike in the sense of that we tend to date Latina women. Mm-hmm. But where he and I differ is the fact that when it comes to black women, this is where we have a huge disagreement. And he's black himself.
Right.
And so, his whole point was that, man, they're ghetto, this and that, yada, yada, yada. But he wants to put like the Latina women way above the black women and he uses this point about that black women are this and that, they're drama, this and this. So he's taking it in that direction. So I'm like, yo.
You said black women drama?
And I'm like,
and
yo.
You taste Latinas?
Exactly. I'm like, I don't know what Latina you've been doing.
Exactly.
Right.
Well, right. But I could make a compelling case that.
Shout out to some toxicas out there.
Toxica. But, you know, some Latina women are just as worse off. So you know, it is just one of those things where it's just like, it'd be those type of things. I don't know if it's just like, you know, maybe people had bad experiences with a particular race, and then they just draw to that conclusion, like, hey, I'm not messing with them.
I think that's what that is.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And that's just not how it's supposed to be, man, because, like, I've dated black, dated white, Latina. I had bad experiences in each and one of them.
Right.
Races. Yeah. So, you know, I mean, you can get it anywhere, man. And so... But
yeah, that's facts.
Yeah, and so that's just saying. That's the thing that I've been kind of curious of, just wanting to know like where that type of mindset frame comes from, and in particular when it comes to, you know, a black man dating a white girl,
right?
And sometimes, you know, and we touched on this at the gym a few days ago where, you have black women, that get upset. Because there are more black men that are dating outside of the race, or in particular the white, the white girl, you know, and it is just that, you know, that issue there, you know, and I think that's what kind of prompted this whole discussion.
But I think that's universal, though. I think the whole thing, everybody wants to be with a white girl, every race, because that's, I think so. Like every, I mean. I think just like the black male. I mean, every black, you know, when you hear like. You know, even Mexican chicks, white chicks, like, oh, I want to be with a, you know, with a black guy, porque está todo, you know? So it's like...
What is that? They didn't hear you. they didn't hear the thud.
The thunder. You know what I mean? But you see what I'm saying? It's like...
But see, I was talking with a homegirl about this, and about how, you know, there's a difference between... preferences and prejudices, like you and I discuss all the time. You know what I mean? Like, you're like, man, blonde chicks, like that's
my weakness.
That's your thing. Blonde chicks and feet, for some reason. But whatever, bro.
Don't listen to the podcast.
Whatever. But what I'm saying, you know. But for me,
assholes.
You know. But for me, like, I don't prefer blondes. You know what I mean? I'm for some reason,
You're weird about that.
You know, I'm weird about that. Like, I don't find blondes in general as attractive. With that being said, I've dated plenty of blondes.
Right.
You know, I've definitely, you know, given them a chance. I'm not prejudiced where I'm like, well, I don't date blondes because they're dumb. No, I've met some dumb brunettes too.
That's like the stereotype.
Exactly. That's what I'm saying. So, you know, to discriminate. Like, it's one thing to have a preference.
Right.
I like redheads. Just do. Always have. Yeah.
But my...
Huh?
You like cholas,
too. I love a chola. That's you know great. What I mean? I do.
I'm an addiction.
What I'm really fascinated with is just, you know, it being a black man and just, you know, seeing some other black men just dissing the black woman just because of...
Now, see, that I don't understand.
Yeah, that's the thing I don't get. And then they have sisters that are black, and I'm like, so you mean to say that your sister's like that as well? You know, and
like your sister's like that? Like your mom's like that? Your aunt's like that? Like, right. Are you saying they're all like that?
And I think I've told y'all this story once. I was out with one of my friends, and I put this to the test because I remember he told me that his preference is that he's like, man, I'm only going to mess with Latinas and white women. That's all. That's it, you know.
What about the Asian ones? They can't get no love?
I know, right? Yeah, right. But when it came to the black woman...
And don't sleep on the Middle Easterns, bro.
But when it came to the black woman, it's a no-go, but he's black himself. So I remember one day I was out, and I put it to the test. Mm-hmm. So I showed him this picture of this black chick I was dating a while ago. She was a model.
Mm-hmm.
Gorgeous, right?
Right.
He
only dates models.
Yeah, that's how I roll, right?
That's how you roll, bro.
So, and I just wanted to prove this point to myself just to get a reaction. So, so he doesn't know what I'm about to show him. So I'm like, hey, yo, bro, tell me what you think of this chick I'm rapping to. He's like, oh, yeah, let me see. King, for real, bro? I was like, what's up? Man, she's black. That was his exact response. That was his exact response. And that, and you know, as being a black man, hearing this from another black person, like, that hit me in a different way. Like, damn. Like, and there was nothing wrong with this woman whatsoever. Other than that, what, because she's black? Is that why? So, you know, but I don't know. Like, that just, you know, I did that deliberately just to see what type of reaction I would get.
Yeah.
And I was right. Mm-hmm. I was right. But where does that derive from? What is that?
Itself, bro. Yeah. That's something within him. Something's wrong with him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he needs to get help.
But,
yeah.
But
he got burnt.
But not only that.
Did you run across that, El Padre? Where someone of the same race will discriminate against their own?
Yeah, I've heard of it being done before. Mm-hmm. As far as me remembering exact person, no, because I just don't. Me being in the military, mm-hmm. we slept with guys. I mean, not together. I know where y'all are going already.
That's like
the Navy.
For people that don't know, Rashad is a veteran Navy, and El Padre is a Marine. So,
that's okay.
So please don't take
it. Y'all real witness on the boat, okay?
We had to keep y'all off us. Get off us, guys. Hey, new meat on ship.
I'm just saying, y'all are fresh meat, okay? Sometimes it worked, sometimes it didn't, okay?
That's funny.
Oh, my God. Yeah, so.
But, I mean, we were a group of brothers, you know? Mm-hmm. We didn't care what color your skin was, you know. Yeah. So we hung out and it didn't matter to us. We didn't see color. Mm-hmm. We just saw, guess what, when we got shot, we're gonna bleed the same color.
Yeah.
That's all that mattered. Mm-hmm. And so when we went out dating women, it didn't matter to us either, because we went to different countries.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's all the same color.
Exactly. You mentioned something though, that a lot of people will say that we don't see color. But I want to highlight that, because in all actuality we do see color. But the difference is like, how do we treat that person?
How we approach
that's a different thing. Color. Well, you know,
and I think you get so close as brothers you don't see.
Yeah,
it.
I mean, well, I get what
because,
you're saying.
Because he knows what I'm talking about.
Yeah, yeah.
You're so
yeah.
close to him, like you don't. You're brothers. You're no longer. Yeah. Hey, he's black, he's white, he's Mexican.
Yeah, yeah,
my brother right there. You know, like them two are so close, they're brothers. They don't no longer see
you know, the
a
thing
difference
is,
in color.
Yeah. Open-minded. That's what the thing is, that open-minded. And these guys don't see that. They say that because they've actually traveled the world. Compared to a moron like myself that hasn't even been outside of Texas, I don't know the life outside of this. This is why, you know, we have prejudice or the hate where we just like, well, I don't like black people. Mm-hmm. Well, what outside of what you're, where have you met other, you know, black people? Because for a long time, I heard black people were lazy. I have worked with some of the hardest working black people, white people. It's just when you get out your comfort zone.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And that's a lot of the time when people just talk because they haven't left their comfort zone. Mm-hmm.
They talk about things outside the circle and they haven't even left their circle.
There you go. And you guys been all over. I remember all the Tang Rashad used to tell me all the thousands of Tangs.
Yeah,
like,
all over
the world.
Yeah, we got to cut to a commercial.
Oh, no. I start snitching. No, but he would tell me all these amazing stories about traveling the world to Italy and how beautiful it looks, or Europe. And, you know, you have mentioned some of those, too. I'm like, I can only imagine.
Iraq, Bahrain, Dubai.
See, what I mean? I've only heard this in
Hey, when you're in Bahrain. There's a bunch of Middle Eastern women.
Yeah, see what I mean?
You figure it out.
That's cool.
And they love Americans.
They do.
Is that why you guys are talking about? Let's go on a road trip?
My wife calls
Bro, we're going to Dubai. Bro, we're going to Dubai.
Yeah. But you see what I mean? That you have to be open-minded. And when these guys go through that, they don't see it. Mm-hmm. Versus me and you.
Either they don't want to see it or they don't want to.
Mm.
You know? Well,
elaborate on that. What you mean?
Well, in a sense of what you said earlier, that, you know, getting out of your comfort zone.
Right.
Some people are just fine and accept the zone that they're in.
Yes.
Not wanting or not willing to branch out to meet someone out mm-hmm. of the race or, mm-hmm. or to try new things or to embrace a different culture.
Right.
And things of that nature. And I think that kind of applies to when it comes to interracial dating. You mm-hmm. know, with some people may be for it. Some people is kind of like, no. And then oftentimes, you know, when it comes to a particular race, when right. when that particular individual doesn't have that contact with that particular race, and they only hear the negative things about that particular race, then how is that going to shape their opinion on whether or not they want to date this particular race? You know right. what I mean?
Yeah, because there are going to be difficulties.
Yeah.
Like, I was raised different than him. I was mm-hmm. raised in a Hispanic family. So yeah. definitely, and probably African-American, right? Am I guessing right? Yeah. Okay, mm-hmm. so here we are. Your style of eating is way different than the style of food that I eat, right? Mm-hmm. So if that was a woman, right, her style of food is different than mine. So she ain't going to like half the stuff I eat. Right. Noodle, like cow stomach. She ain't gonna want to eat that. You know what I'm saying? So then that comes a point that
just
yes,
put some
seasoning
on there. It's all good.
Yeah, I know, right? It's tripas after that.
Exactly.
Right?
Right?
It's good. Shitlins is what you're saying. Yeah.
There you go.
So no, I mean there are things that y'all have to work through that are different.
Right.
And when it's blended races.
Yeah.
You know, of course. You know, the style of foods are different. You right. know, and that's getting to know that person. You know, for more than what you just see on the outside or for what you're trying to look between the legs, you know, it's more than that. It's growing a relationship. And when you grow a relationship, it takes everything, their faults, their weaknesses.
Absolutely.
And that's the whole purpose of a man and a woman getting together so that they can build each other up.
Right. Yeah. And together. What you just mentioned there, all of those things are just obstacles for a love, for a person, for one another, has to go through.
Right.
Because,
yes.
you know, if it comes to true love, that should trump all that stuff. Well, see, the culture differences, the, you know, the way of eating and the whole nine, there has to be some sort of a common ground between
right.
the two parties, you know.
See, that's where I disagree. I don't think those are obstacles. I think those are benefits. Because, like for instance, when I was dating Mexican women,
mm-hmm.
and they would cook for me.
Mm.
It'd be different than what I'd grown up with, but to me that was interesting. You know, I had foods I never got to eat before. You know what
right.
I mean? If it's kind of like if all your girl can cook is fried pork chops.
Yeah.
All you're eating is fried pork chops.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know
right.
what I mean?
You know, but now you got a little variety.
Exactly.
Diet,
like,
you know.
It's like, oh, what the heck is this?
Yeah,
like, oh, it's a torta. I was like, oh, shit, all right, cool. That's what's up. It's like, what's this? Oh, it's menudo. I was like, all right, cool. That's what's up.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So, like those things, those cultural differences, I don't see them as obstacles so much as I see them as benefits.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, I can see that. Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
sure, there might be some, you know, miscommunications. Like, I'll give you one example.
Oh, go ahead.
I was dating a particular Latina woman, and whenever she was angry with me, she would add more spice to the cooking.
Like, I'm gonna get
right?
you on this one. Hold
exactly.
You ain't seen nothing.
But the thing is, I'm a black dude.
Oh, we
I like spice.
Exactly.
So I would think that I was like, oh snap! I was like, you really make this good. Okay, you really love me. Okay,
our spicy food hits a little different.
Exactly.
That's
I'm
all,
just
that's
like,
all, but it's all
you know,
spicy.
Exactly. She's like, oh, how's the food? I was like,
oh, dang, girl,
really
you got
good.
Some food.
Hey, this was up. She's like, okay, fine. I was like, I'm really liking this. Like,
right.
I don't get it. Like,
yeah.
Little did I know, she was angry at something, and I'm thinking like, oh, well, everything's great.
Right.
Yeah. You know, that's a good way of putting it out there, though. And going back to what I mentioned about the obstacles,
mm-hmm.
We can also look at it in a sense of like, say if there's two people that's in an interracial dating.
Mm-hmm.
I guess an obstacle would be an example of like, what the families will feel about it. If they're old school and if they're like, no, I can't have you hanging out with this
I've had that.
This black.
I can honestly
you know,
say that my family.
And then,
yeah.
then that puts a strain on the relationship there, you know? And, you know, my I never had that type of situation before, but my little sister has. She was with an Asian guy. Real cool dude from China.
Yaming?
Mm-hmm. And I mean, treated her very well. I mean, and I think they were on the verge of getting married in the whole nine. You know, well, I guess he was wanting to probably pop the question or whatever.
Right.
But I wouldn't be against it or anything like that. Right. I'm like, shoot, hey, brother-in-law, hey, right. Welcome to the family, you know?
Right.
But the problem was with his folks.
His folks.
Mm. And, you know, they were very old school and everything, and they didn't like the fact that he was
with the old school, they were racist. Well, I think a lot of times people cover up like, oh yeah, my granny, you know, she's old school. Like, no, my granny racist.
Yeah, you know. So I mean, I never met his parents before. And then also another big factor of it was, and it has nothing to do with this topic, but he was, he didn't really believe in God or anything like that. So he was
interfaith type of thing. Yeah.
And so they had some issues with that as well. Added with the tension amongst, you know, his parents and his little sister. So so that was kind of like an obstacle example, I will say, for what some interracial couples may have to deal with. And it's more so of like, what the family, how they are accepting to that.
Right.
But
I can kind of understand how, you know, knowing that, you know, all relationships are going to have some sort of obstacles and stuff like that.
Right.
And if you add, you know, two different cultures into it,
right,
that adds a different dynamic. Me personally, I don't think that adds any more problems. But it does add different problems.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, you know, I bring a black chick home. Yeah, granny's going to be cool, but she crazy as hell.
Yeah.
So, you know what I mean? Yeah. So, you know, so now my granny's not bitching, but now I'm not happy. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But would your granny be cool or happy the fact that because she's a black woman?
Yes.
Okay. I just want
my granny? Yes. 100%.
Yeah.
100%. Yeah. Like, yeah. Trust me, the women that I've brought that she's seen me with that weren't black, she let it be known that she was not happy with them.
Yeah.
So
that's why I said, like, that's why I made a mention about like the old era, because some of those people still have that type of mindset,
right,
just considering how it was like at that time, you know, especially when it comes to black and white. I mean, we could go on days about
she
that.
Granny was less passive aggressive when I had Mexican chicks than when I had white chicks.
I didn't understand
either. I'm just like,
my mom was always trying to hit me up with Mexican women, you know, she was like, hey, I want you to marry a Mexican girl and have me Mexican kids.
Yeah.
And I was like, Mom, but I don't see any pretty Mexican girls that I like.
Exactly.
They're all area. Toxic as in crazy. Mm-hmm. I know who you are.
Exactly. They just wasn't there. Yeah.
Yeah.
No,
I think that is like something that is real too. Like the pressure that our families may put on us in dating our race or you know what I mean? Just you know. Like what you just said about, like, you know, mom's like, oh, you know, I want you to, you know, be with a Mexican girl to have all these babies and this and that, you know, instead of saying like, you know, oh, you know, I want you to bring home a, you know, a beautiful girl that you like,
right,
you know, not having to be particularly in a certain race, you know,
that's gonna treat you right.
Exactly.
Think about, you know, the feelings and how they're gonna treat you and respect. Exactly. Your mother, you know, your brothers and everything, that respect fact, and not so much as, you know, what does race have to do with it?
Right.
You know?
Exactly.
Right.
Yeah.
Do you guys think that it's probably because of, like, when I was younger, my mom kind of would, you know, bring that up, but not really. As I got older, she saw that I was into other ethnicities. And my question to you guys, do you think probably thing is the same struggles? Like, if I date a Mexican chick knows what's up, like, you know, the traditional Mexican chick will, you know, serves you the plate and is very, you know, hospitality towards the in-laws, and
they have those strict gender roles.
Right. Exactly.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Compared to like if I dated a white girl or another, you know, ethnicity, they probably wouldn't know the, like, oh man, you know, you're not supposed to do that. Or like if, you know what I mean? Like if you served your own plate, having your wife, they would be like, oh.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
Did you see him? Oh, wow. You know what I mean? And it's kind of like, That's what I mean. Do you think it's probably because a Mexican chick knows the set, you know, would know?
I know there's certain, like...
That's the only thing that makes dating within your race. Me, personally,
right.
What I believe the only thing that makes dating within your race easier is because they would know those culture norms that there your you family go. There knows. You go.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I think what you were just touching on, I think those are, like, just different customs right. that you know, other races may have when it right. comes to serving, you know, their significant other a plate or something like that, you know. Mm-hmm.
But do we not know that's the natural, like, in Bible days, that's how women were supposed to treat their men no matter what? So why are all women all together treating their men that way?
Man, times have changed, my brother. Times have changed.
Where did it go from it's the man now serving the woman instead of the woman serving the man after the man's been at work all day long providing for the family?
Well, because I think that... Because I think that's kind of leading to another topic in the sense of life. Yeah. Like, you know, because now you're having women that are more independent, that work in as much or even more than some men.
I've heard this.
So that...
I heard a couple of brothers, you know, a couple of black guys be like, well, I'm with a Mexican chick because they know how to treat a man. Compared to, like, you know, I'm not with a black chick because she out there loud and crazy.
Yeah, again, what I touched on earlier right. is like... It's almost like, and it, when it comes to a black guy in particular, it's like, it's another way of just putting a black woman down.
Right.
And like they would use any other race, just like what you just said. Oh, right. I want to get with a Mexican.
Yeah.
Because they know how to treat a man.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And with them black women. You know what I'm saying?
And I'm like, the same way though. You told me, I'm like, man, Mexican chicks are crazy. They don't listen. They're crazy. Jealous.
And I would ask that person, like, so do your mama, does she not know how to treat a man? Or right. does your sister not know how to treat a man? Like, right. like you know, we got to stop with these generalizations, though. You know what I mean? That's the thing.
Sorry, I got flashbacks.
Yeah.
I was going to a church for a year with my friend. His name is Pastor Jack Crane, and it's predominantly black. Mm-hmm. The only light color people were there was me and my white wife. Mm-hmm. Okay, that was going to the church. And most of those women would teach the younger women, saying, if you want to keep your husband, then you're going to treat him right. You're going to serve him, take care of him, and love him, you know? And so I don't agree that it's like it's getting out of the race. I just think it's a lot of people not teaching their daughters the right way, okay, when it comes to that. Because if a mother teaches her daughter saying, hey, if you want to keep your husband, then you better spread your legs whenever he asks you to, you know, because that's all he wants from you. And then guess what? He'll do whatever he asks. Right. You ask him to do because that is his weakness. Mm-hmm. Okay, that is a way to a man's heart where a woman is more emotional, a man is more physical.
Right.
Okay, we're on two different levels. If a woman meets our physical needs, we'll do anything that a woman wants emotionally, because they got our weakness.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And when women learn how to do that instead of using the penene as a weapon and saying, guess what? You pissed me off. I ain't giving you none this week or this month.
Off you know? Limits.
That's whenever the division of a marriage, no matter what color it is, interracial, right. you know, or inracial, yeah. whatever, it doesn't matter. That's when a marriage is going to dissolve.
And then they get mad because you got a side chick.
then they get mad.
Nerve with these women.
How dare you?
I dare you. Call me out on that.
Yeah,
but I can see your point, Padre.
I think. Oh, go ahead.
No, you're good.
No, I was gonna say. I think that's. I don't think that is unique to black women. I don't think that's unique to any particular group of women. I really think that is unique to the times that we're in right now.
Yep.
So in the times that we're in right now. Me personally, just observing, it's that equality, and we're having this equality without fairness. It's like I always say, not everything that's equal is fair. Not everything that's fair is equal. If if I'm working 60 hours a day, 60 hours a week, 50 hours a week, and I say, you know what, I'm going to pay for all of our, I'm going to take care of all of our financial responsibilities. Cool. Would it be fair if I were to wash dishes? No. Because I'm not asking you to contribute anything financially. So why right. would I have to contribute anything on this end?
Right.
But I'm not saying, you know, yeah. to be a slob or anything. Yeah, like that. Yeah, yeah. But is that sort of being not necessarily being equal, but as in if my woman isn't equal financially mm-hmm. and I'm not equal when it comes to running the household,
yeah.
then we are compatible. Right. As in
everything flows
exactly.
together. Everything
flows. I'm doing things that she's not doing and she's doing things I'm not doing. Mm-hmm. So, but things are getting done.
Yeah. Right?
But in today's time, with everything quote unquote being equal, it's the, well, the woman says, well, I make money, you make money, but I still want you to pay all these bills. Mm. I make money, you make money, I still want you to go half on cleaning. Mm. It's like, if we're both doing the same thing, not everything is getting done.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know what I mean? But again, that's just my.
I think it comes with a, you know, in a sense of like, I guess, entitlements that people may,
100%,
you know, feel like they have because, I bring home this type of income or I'm putting this. So I think to resolve that, I think you know, they have to have some sort of understanding of what needs to be done around the house.
Right.
What bills do need to be paid and stick with that and right. and not have this competition of who's going to be the breadwinner, and that shouldn't have to be an issue if it's about two people who really love each other.
Right.
You know what I mean?
And that could be solved with communication. Exactly. See,
yep.
in olden times whatsoever or whatever, it was automatically assumed that the man was going to provide because. Back then, the woman could not. There was no yeah. avenue yeah. for a woman mm-hmm. to do that. But now that there's avenues for women to do that,
lawyers that bring it in.
Exactly.
You know, now, six figures off the muscle.
Exactly. You know? Now you have the dynamics where women are capable of mm-hmm. are providing these things of doing things that were strictly for the men.
Right.
And so with that being said, now it's going to be a communication thing. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what what's lacking in the conversation. Mm-hmm. When we talk about, well, everything's equal. Well, I'm making all the money, so he should be doing this. I'm making, well, yeah. have you talked
to him about that? It's just that assumption. That,
exactly.
Yeah, that's just that assumption. Have you talked to him about that? Hasn't even been discussed.
Have you, yes. do you want, you know, well, I don't want a man if he can't, yeah. if he can't pay all my bills, yeah. he can't do a lot of, all that stuff. Oh, okay. That's fine. If that's what you want, you have these requirements. Mm-hmm. Okay, well, I have these requirements.
Yes.
And then we're going to communicate to see where we meet.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And I think all women have these requirements. I just think that the stereotypical black woman is more vocal. And so that's where they get that stereotype from.
Yeah, know? I can see that. I can see that because, you know, when it comes to the black man in particular, I don't know if we be a fun of confrontation when it comes from a woman like that, if we get called on our shit, mm-hmm. you know what I'm saying? And black women are more vocal to express that. And so so we have to make that distinction of how we're going to take that type of confrontation when mm-hmm. when she's telling you that you're not doing your role, but then you may take it as, man, she crazy, man, she always drama, this and that, yada right. yada yada, you know what I'm saying? And it kind of goes back to what you said about maybe that kind of adds into some of the stereotypes, negative stereotypes of what some black man will perceive a black woman.
And with that being said, I don't think the onus is on on black women to curb their emotionality and that sort of stuff. I think it's on men, because first of all, it's always on men,
right,
in order to have that accountability. Women, yep, are not going to take accountability for anything.
Yeah.
That's a whole nother subject.
But you know, let's put a pin on that, and we're gonna go on break.
It's getting real. Yeah.
It's all right. We're gonna go on break, and we're gonna play Rashad's top.
No, two. I think you picked this one.
Top,
right?
Two picks of the.
That's right.
Today.
Manny picked the picks. Roll them.
My life being a color.
Would you agree with me when I saw you kicking dirt in my eye?
Remember you when you drink my wine.
Why can't we be friends?
What is up, everybody? Welcome back. If you guys been tuning in, show some love. Give us your input. Now, how you really feel? What do you think about interracial relationship? Or if you want to see Rashadi the cupcake,
in a manly way.
Yeah. Manly much love way. To El Padre, my boy Akeem, man, out here.
Yes. You know, thank you show so us much love
and
through.
Duque.
Yes, sir.
We thank want Duque. Duque. Give us your input, man. What do you think about this whole situation? I know you're a wise man.
And just like last week, do what you want to do. Like, love who you love.
There you go.
There shouldn't be a color behind who you love.
Right?
There really shouldn't. But I've kind of noticed that, and I had this conversation with one of my big bros. He'll know when I say this, is that sometimes some people just date race, and they'll be like, oh, yeah, just to say they did it.
Mm-hmm. But I do love means to take white girls.
Hey, facts. I love them all, though. As long as you think, I love you.
Two C's or three C's, son?
Damn, Dave.
Dookie's a 3-4 C man.
He just bubbled in all the above.
1-6.
Boy.
Dookie's like some thick.
I didn't know when it came that thick, bro. Hold on.
God damn.
But for real, I have, you know, I was having a conversation with one of my big bros, and he was just saying, yeah, sometimes, like, white chicks will go with these dudes that, you know, just to say they've been with the black guy. I think a lot of people do that, though. I mean, what do you guys think?
If you look back historically, like when it comes to black and white, it's almost like the unforbidden fruit. You know, the forbidden fruit you know, back in segregation and things of that nature. Whereas, if you were to look at a white woman, if you're black, that would have cost you your life. You know,
it did cost several.
It cost several black men their lives. You know, so I think, you know, as time progressed and you know, society has changed and there's more interracial dating and stuff, there's that opportunity now to date a white woman or a black woman. So there's that curiosity that comes with it. Mm-hmm. You know, like, oh my gosh, I've never been with this person and, you know, this particular race, and then it just kind of goes from there, you know.
Right.
So I think the flip side of discriminating against, you know, of someone of a certain race when it comes to dating and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And I'm just talking discrimination when it comes to dating. There's also what I call fetishizing. You know, it's kind of like how, you know, someone to look at, like, I know a lot of guys that'll be like, oh man, I'm gonna give me an Asian, man, because they just crazy in bed, man. It's like, first of all, have you ever met an Asian?
Yeah, right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Like, but that's probably the reason. You know?
But that's the thing. It's like they're fetishizing. Like, why don't you talk to her? Like, why don't you? Yeah. Like, why don't you see her as a whole
nerd?
You know what I mean?
Yeah, I get you.
You know, there's a lot of, you know, or, you know, I'm sure you've heard it too, or you guys have heard it. Like, it's like, oh man, I'm gonna give me a Latina because they're spicy and bad.
Yeah, I was just about to touch on that. Like, a lot of women do too. Well, I'm gonna give myself a Latina because they're spicy. No, not all of them. So, not all of us.
No.
Yeah. So.
Yeah. I mean, there's, and I've probably told you this. I was like, because I would say sometimes, like, I know when a white woman is going to sleep with me.
Yeah.
Because she'll say, I've never been with a black dude.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean?
I think that's what...
You know, because that's fetishizing. Yeah, like, I already know you're fetishizing.
I think it's like that in all types of races, if mm-hmm. they haven't been with that particular race, and it could be with like the attention that you may get and everything, because, you know, I could speak of from experience in a sense of like, what's that right now?
No, I'm touching on what you were saying, fetishizing. Stuff like that. It's the novel of it. The picture we're looking at, I don't know if you can see that.
Yeah, the novelty. Yeah, that's the thing. It's the novelty of it. Like, they fetishize or sexualize, you know, just the person, you know what I mean? Like, or they fetishize and sexualize, you know, the race and stuff like that.
Yes, I would say that's the
dark twin to discriminating.
Right.
Yeah.
Because now you're running to it because, like, oh man, I'm going to give me a white girl because they freaks. They let you do everything.
Yeah. I hear that a lot.
And you know what was crazy?
I will have to touch
on that.
That's not always true.
I'm married to one. She's screwed.
You know, I'll have to touch on that from experience. Because I don't know if I told you this, but I studied abroad in Mexico back in 2011.
How many broads?
Man, I can't even. Yeah.
You study broads, bro.
Yeah. Oh, snap.
Is that called women's studies? Anyway,
and this is one of the things that I wasn't prepared for when I arrived in Mexico for the first time, is the attention that I got by simply being a black man, because I'm now in an environment where I'm like pretty much damn near the only brother in the city. Mm-hmm. I mean, and it was so fascinating. Like, when I saw another black person, we would be fascinated. Like, oh my gosh, hold on, wait. Hey, man, come on, bring it in, man. But when it came to the women in particular, and I never understood it at first, but until later, because it made me uncomfortable quite a bit, because, like, people kept looking at me like I was, like, Bigfoot or something, you know? And, like, girls in my class wanted to, like, touch my hair and all that shit. But when some of them took the initiative to try to get to know me, and at some point in the conversation, they would always try to allude to the fact of what, or allude to the myth, the black myth of a black man. If you get what I'm saying,
you're hung like a horse.
Yeah,
and you could say
big black cock.
Yeah, you can say it.
Yeah,
this is safe space. This is safe space.
But you know, I think it ties into what you were talking about.
It does, and the thing is, it's like, sure, that attention is cool,
but is it really?
But after a while, it's like, after a while, it's just like, okay, so I'm just
a piece of meat.
Sex object.
Exactly, I'm just a sex object. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know if you've experienced this, but I've experienced where I would have been dating a chick, you know, and I'm thinking like, oh man, we're cool, we're kicking it, like. This could be something. And I'm just like, you know, maybe you can meet my mom, and, you know, I'll meet your parents and stuff like that. It's like, no, you can't meet my parents. Well, why not? Nah, they wouldn't accept you. So, I mean, this is pretty much as far as it's going to go. It's like, oh, it's like that. Yeah. Like, but those type of experiences are, I think, are equally as bad as someone saying, like, I'm not going to date black dudes because
I agree with you, man. Because baby mamas, because now kind of you're a novelty, you know. Because exactly. That eventually wears out. It and does. What happens when that wears out? And then the, also another problem with that is that some women may come at you for that particular reason, but then they will hit you with another angle, like, "Oh, Rashad, you're not like any other guy, and this and that." Mm-hmm. But there's a hidden agenda behind it.
Yep.
They want to see what you like in the bed. Mm-hmm. Or they want you to, you know, pay that car note. Or, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Whatever the case may be, whatever right. their tent may be. Mm-hmm. And then once when that novelty wears out, mm-hmm. that's it.
Well, they call you, the, you know, when the novelty wears out, they'll, oh, you're just another N-word.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
they'll start. Again, it happens to us Mexicans too. Like, again, yeah. When they think it's just passionate, it's like I said, it's not always like that. Same thing, man, we think like that. I hear a lot of my buddies, oh, I just want to date a white girl. Or I want to date an Asian chick. Or my black friends be like, I want to be with a Latina. I'll be like, why? Oh, it's because they're more submissive or they'll listen. Or yeah. like, where have you been getting your information from, bro? Yeah. That's you haven't been a really.
It's like people have to be so specific yeah. of what they, you know. But
yeah.
But and that's.
And I think the only way they're going to get somebody like that is from someone from another country that's not Americanized like us.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yes, it.
You see what I'm saying? Because yeah. in America, women have so much privileges where in other countries, the women aren't. So they are still subservient.
They don't have the options.
They don't have the options.
I know this is a different topic, too.
Yeah.
But it comes to bringing foreign chicks from a different country.
Once they become Americanized.
Yes.
You get the same problems.
No, well not
that's why you don't let them out of the house. No. Keep them locked in. Come on. Get with the program.
Yeah.
See? That's why we bring you on the show. Yeah. For those good ideas. That's a good one.
Oh, yeah. Made myself a Russian girl.
Exactly.
You doing?
Never let her out.
My name will be
break you.
Sergey.
I went to go to the store. No, baby. I'll go to the store for exactly. you.
It's okay, Svetlana. We'll build Svetlana. You. We'll build you an ice rink down in the basement. You can skate to your heart's content.
Right.
Or maybe do gymnastics. I don't know. Whatever.
Whatever you Russian girls do. Yeah. I fight bears. Okay.
Whatever, yeah,
you know, that's okay. Yeah. But yeah, no, it happened.
I've called a bear before. Teddy bear, but it still counts, right?
I'm not even going
to go there. No?
But yeah, so, I mean, again, the whole novelty thing, it does wear off. And again, mm-hmm. meet a person for what they are, you know. Yes. Again, if we're going to exchange, I think I said this to my brother Rashad. I said, if I date a different race, don't try to be like me. Be you. I'm dating you.
Yes.
Let's exchange.
Yeah. Be yourself.
Yeah. Like when, like I said, if I date a white girl, then I want her to be whatever white people are. I don't know, honestly. But what? Don't try to be all ghetto hood. Don't try to be Mexican. Yes. Don't try to appropriate. No. Be you. Mm-hmm. Teach me. Or if I date an African chick straight from Africa, show me. Teach me. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know. Let's have some. You know, like what you
I
said.
I think that's in general, like outside of like. Relate intimate relationships and stuff, like just even from like, you know, dealing with coworkers and stuff. You mm-hmm. know, I can recall I flew with a pilot, a white guy, and I don't know, it was interesting when it came to me. It was like everything had to be like super hip. What's up, man? You put on
a black scent.
Yeah,
it was just like a lot of images. Yeah. Like, and you know, I'm just like, hey, how's it going, man? You know,
What's up, big dog?
It was just like,
that happens to us too.
Yeah, white
people put on that Mexican accent. Yeah. What's all going on?
There you go. And that's one thing I do hate, and I'll tell anybody, if you come to me, you go, "What's up, SA?" with the whole Cali, I call it the Cali accent. Your homes. I don't talk like that, homie.
I don't really know. Ask this fool, man.
Talk to me. Hey, shake my hand. Hey, my name is Matt. Yeah, nice to meet you. You know? Nah, that's it for you, Duke. You do that.
Yeah. And I think everyone has probably had that type of encounter before.
Or people act like, you don't, I don't know if you had this before, but people will act like you don't speak English, so they'll talk louder with their hands.
Yes.
Oh, hola, amigo. Hey. And I'm like, hey, I speak English. Oh, my God. I'm so embarrassed. Are you, though? Like, you're really not. You're not.
No.
Yeah.
You're not sorry.
That would probably bother me right there.
You're not
that
embarrassed.
Would,
you're
that
racist.
That would probably bother me.
This ain't what it is.
Now, side note. So,
side check?
Yeah. No. What?
No.
Maybe. No, as you guys know, like, I do construction. So, you know, there's... Yeah, so there's different ethnicities, a lot of Mexicans and stuff like that. So, but sometimes my coworkers will not be Mexican; they'll be, you know, white or black or stuff like that. And so, I mean, most of my coworkers, like, by now, they know that I can speak Spanish. So, but when I go to a job site, I usually speak to everyone in English until they tell me that they speak Spanish.
Right.
Or they only speak Spanish. If they only speak Spanish, then I'll switch. And so one of my coworkers asked me, it's like, bro, how come, like, why are you talking to Carlos in English when you just talk to him in Spanish?
Right.
It's like,
but you because. You were addressing a whole crowd. Exactly.
Well, it's because I'm not going to assume that he doesn't speak English.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, that's, to me, that's more rude.
Oh, yeah. Oh,
you know absolutely. What I mean? Like if I just go up to him and I'm just like, it's like, hola, señor, you know, I'm just like, sure, that's respectful. Yeah. But to me, that would be disrespectful. Like, bro, like no, I speak English. All right, cool. Then we'll speak English. You know
right.
what I mean? You know what I mean? Unless you're my homie, then I'm like, count away. You know what I mean? Like,
in the badge.
In the badge.
You know, that's you interesting. Know what I mean? You mentioned that because I had a story. This happened to me a few weeks back. I was working a flight to Guadalajara, Mexico.
Mm-hmm.
And this passenger stopped me. And she had a question about some immigration forms that she had to fill.
Mm-hmm.
And she's like, hey, do I have to fill these out to go to customs and stuff? And I'm like, yeah, sure. You know, it wouldn't hurt to fill them out just to be on the safe side. And then she goes on and says that, you know, she hasn't traveled in 2 years and she's looking forward to seeing her family. So mind you, this conversation is in English, and I'm like, oh, so are you from Guadalajara? And she's like, yes, yeah, I'm from Guadalajara. And then from there I switched it into Spanish. So I was like, oh, supongo que si hablas español también. So I'm like, oh, so I suppose you speak Spanish as well. And she's like, oh yeah, that's my first language. And so we started having this conversation in Spanish for a little bit, and then she switches back to English and she says, I'm glad that you didn't assume that I just didn't speak English.
Mm-hmm.
Mm.
And so that's true with what you just said.
Like,
it, like that impressed her as well, that the fact that I spoke the language.
Right.
But the fact that I didn't just off the bat disculpe and just
exactly.
You know what I'm saying? Like,
exactly.
You know, so she acknowledged that. And so that's
where really o cool. is the baño o. Yeah.
right.
What?
For people that are just listening, Akeem and Rashad are both black and they both speak Spanish. So.
And we're both Mexican.
And we're both Mexican. Actually, hold on. Funny story. The other day when I was teaching my class, there's a lot of people people know that I speak English, but I do speak Spanish. I'm not going to sit there and say, I don't speak Spanish. I'm not one of those. I'm not going to be one of those no sabo kids. I do speak Spanish.
Yeah, I'm the coconut here.
But, I mean, when I do speak it, it takes me a while because sometimes I'm processing the words, right? Mm-hmm. So the other day, I was teaching them, my students, how to do a dodge a punch by doing the U, right? So I'm like, and they speak Spanish. Mm-hmm. So I have to speak Spanish to some of my students because they don't speak English, I think, one of the young ones. So I said, you have to do a U, and I'm showing them. So as I'm showing them, I'm like, a U. And I said, man, I asked one of the ladies that speaks Spanish, hey, how do you say U in Spanish? And then he's the one that goes,
he's like, ooh.
Ooh. Yeah. I'm like, where?
No, ooh. Yeah. That's how you say U in Spanish, ooh. Yeah.
Bro, when I say everybody paw, like, hit their head. Like, I was kind of embarrassed. I'm like, I should know this, but I don't. So
no, what was it? The other day you asked me how to spell the Spanish word or something like
that. Yes.
But also, I could explain some of the reasons for that because it would be, but it depends on how you're exposed to that language.
Right.
Because, you know, it's kind of one of those things where, like, people look at Latinos that are taking Spanish classes. They're like, why the hell are you going to be taking Spanish if you speak Spanish?
I'm one of those people,
by the way. But people don't realize that the Spanish that is in a classroom setting is different from the streets.
Yes,
so
it is.
When you're taking
Castilian,
you know,
Spanish in class.
Yeah.
Yeah, mm-hmm. and you know, Latin American Spanish, the whole nine. And so, you know, when you're getting that in a classroom setting, you're getting the formal way of speaking Spanish.
We don't talk like that.
The grammar way. And so, whereas, like, you know, say if it's a Hispanic who was born in the States, but who was brought up speaking Spanish, they're not being taught the former way of how to speak it grammatically correct and the whole nine yards.
Right, right, right.
As if he was in, or he or she is in that classroom setting. Mm, yeah. So that's why, you know, some Latinos
mm-hmm. no, yeah.
may have those. Yeah. Those
but issues. I've actually heard Mexicans like, oh, I don't want to learn Spanish. Like, they're, you know, kind of like ashamed or just they're like, oh, for
that's
what?
That's crazy, man.
Yeah, and I'm like, it's beneficial to speak both languages anywhere you go.
Oh, absolutely.
Not just Spanish and English, but anywhere you go. Learn it there.
My kids, they don't want to learn Spanish.
Yeah.
See, I'm really thinking that's an American thing. Because I know you've been overseas, and how many times we've been overseas, people that spoke 2-3 different languages.
Oh, we were trying to pick it up.
We're way behind.
We went to different
exactly,
countries.
Exactly.
The United States is one of the only countries where you could spend the rest of your life only speaking
one language. Yeah, yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And then you hear people say, speak American. Well, what is American? Please please elaborate.
Cause... It's just, mm-hmm. you know, I had a, you know, and I will say this, that it, I don't know if it's just an American thing, but, you know, I think it comes to, like, just people who are native language is English,
mm-hmm.
especially when it regards to traveling in other countries.
Right.
Oftentimes we have this assumption or tendency where we expect other people to come to us in English, mm-hmm. although we're in their country.
I've seen that,
when,
bro.
And when there's that language barrier, they will still look at you funny like,
mm-hmm.
but you in that country though. Yeah. You know what I'm
exactly.
saying?
Well,
I remember when I was a manager at a grocery store, and the guy that was working behind the counter that worked with me, my assistant manager, he was white.
Mm-hmm.
And a lady came to the counter, and she was trying to send a Western Union to Mexico. And she was speaking in Spanish, right? So mm-hmm. he didn't understand a single word she said, mm-hmm. right? And she's getting mad and irate. So I come over there, and I'm like, okay, let me translate. And I translated what she wanted. And I was like, hey, she wants to send a Western Union. This is a number. This is a place. And I just gave her all the information. And then she starts going off. Why is he working here if he can't speak Spanish? And I was like, no. Why are you here in America and can't speak English?
Okay. Yeah.
And I told her that in Spanish. I said, no, you're in America now, so you need to learn how to speak English. Just
right.
like I know how to speak Spanish in English.
Right.
You need to do the same.
It's just like, mm-hmm. It is just, and I think, you know, some people fail to realize that, you know, I don't know if it's just they look at one thing that, you know, people just don't want to learn English, or, you know, and in some cases that may be, but you know, if you haven't learned a foreign language, it's some hard shit, man.
Depending
on it is
what, you know, if you capable of, I mean, everyone is capable of doing whatever they want to mm-hmm. do, but, like,
right.
you know, some people can grasp on languages quicker than others. You know, it all boils down to if you really want to learn that particular language,
right?
But
my thing is, like, why limit yourself? You know what I mean? Like, why, you know, and especially if, you know, here in America, we're a melting pot.
Yeah, we're
so,
a melting pot.
Yeah.
So, you know, there's, you know, if you go to Louisiana, if you speak French, you're good.
Oh, yeah, you're good.
You know what I mean? Like, you know, if you go, you know, up in the Midwest, you know, Montana, Wyoming, stuff like that, you know, speaking a little German, that'll get you in with the Amish. You know what I mean? So, like,
that's like, facts, bro.
You know what I mean? If you chilling out in Frisco or Seattle, hey, man, learning a little Vietnamese, a little Korean,
yeah,
dude. You know what I mean?
That's crazy. On the French thing, now I did hear this. A girl said that she wished her grandmother would have taught her French while she was growing up. But her grandmother didn't want to pass on the slave language that she had.
Mm. Mm. See, a lot of that.
Because that wasn't her language. That was a slave language that she had to learn.
Yeah.
So that's another reason why.
See, I understand that, but English is a slave language too.
Yeah.
So, you know what I mean? So, like, you know, so, you know, that's, I guess, you know, for me, I think I was, I don't know who I was talking to, but me as an African American, you know, I don't have any language ties to my home country. You know, I don't even
I'm on that same boat.
I don't even know where my home country is.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So
unless we can do that DNA thing, you know.
Like, but even then, know, like, Africa is a continent yes. with 64 different countries.
So when you break it down, we may be from
exactly. Yeah. So you know what I mean. So with that being said, you know, if I were you know, if I knew my heritage came from Mexico, like, me learning Spanish gives me a direct tie to my ancestors.
Right.
Yes.
You know what I mean? Yes. Like, to me, like, why would I not want to learn Spanish? Yeah. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah, I get you.
Like, I would be, you know, ecstatic. You know what I mean?
And
like,
I think all this ties to what you mentioned earlier in the beginning of the show, Manny, that just being open-minded and being accepting. Mm-hmm. And it ties in well when it comes to languages.
Further with that, yeah,
yeah. Because going back to like where we as English speakers, because I don't want to say just only Americans, you know, I just think that is just people who are accustomed to speaking English. When we go to other countries, we expect others to come at us in English. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So I had a situation once. I was in Havana, Cuba. This was probably about 3 years ago.
Cigars?
Oh, I bought a case, man. Yeah, thanks, man. Nice, man.
Appreciate that.
this was during a time when tourism was booming, and this wasn't too long when Obama came down there, was trying to fix things up with the whole embargo thing.
Right.
And tourism opened up for U.S. citizens, so we was able to travel there. And I hopped on that in a heartbeat.
Yes.
It was amazing, man. Mm-hmm. I recommend everyone to go to Cuba, man. I mean, it was just a learning experience, man. But anyways, I'm in this area called La Plaza de San Francisco. Mm-hmm. And it's right on the coast. And this is where the cruise ships will park at. And the passengers will get off and they'll kind of roam the cities. Mm-hmm. So in Havana, Cuba, there's so many blacks that look just like you and me. Mm-hmm. I mean, we go to Havana right now, they think we Cuban.
Mm-hmm.
And if you speak to them in English, they looking at you like, what? Tú no eres cubano. You're not Cuban. Yeah. Like, where are you from?
Yeah.
So I see this
black. Dominican is different.
So it's broad daylight, and I see this black man, and my watch wasn't working at the time, so I couldn't find a way to tell the time. Mm-hmm. So I approached this gentleman, and I said, disculpen, señor, ¿qué hora es? Mm-hmm. So I said, excuse me, sir, what time is it? Mm-hmm. This is literally how he responded.
It just take it off?
Yeah,
take
just throws it. His hands in the air and walks off as if I held him at gunpoint.
Wow.
And I was so offended, man, like just the way he reacted. Mm-hmm. And, you know, no telling if he was African American or not. Mm-hmm. You know, probably so. I'm going to make the assumption that he probably was. I don't know. But, you know, In retrospect, I should have said something like, "Hey, you know, FYI, we are in Havana, Cuba. They do speak Spanish in Cuba, so if a man speaks to you in Spanish, you know, you should." But the thing is that when you're traveling abroad like that, I'm not saying that you have to be fluent in that language, but just take the initiative. Learn a couple of phrases.
Yeah.
And everybody knows this, whether if you don't speak Spanish or not, no Espanol.
Well, we got debriefed.
No.
Every time we had a point.
We got debriefed.
We got briefed.
Yeah, really? or just no. And that would have just killed all that. I'd be like, oh, then I would have turned it in English. Oh, my bad, man. Hey, my watch is broke, man. I was just asking you what time is it, bro.
Take it. It's all yours. Well, I have a question for you guys. Well, hold on. I want to give a great shout out to Gilbert. You said the show sounds great. Thank you, Gilbert.
Thanks.
Now, my question for you guys. Okay, so scientists predicted within another 50, I think if I'm correct, 50 years, 100 years, that there will no longer be one race. Like, there will be no black people, there will be no Mexicans or whites, because we will all be, you know, into mixed, one. Yeah. Into one. Mm-hmm. Do you guys, are you guys afraid that, like, your heritage might be lost, or your race might be lost? Or, you know, what do you think on that, too? Like, do you think our Mexican race would be lost?
We all came from Adam and Eve to begin with, so we're all related in some way.
So wouldn't it just be coming full circle?
Yeah, be coming back full
That's
circle.
That's what I'm saying.
Exactly.
I think that hits it right there.
Yeah.
You know, that kind of, you know, I never gave that a particular thought with that question that you
Well, it's because the scientists are predicting it. Because you touched on it earlier. We said we're one melting pot. Dude, it's almost impossible. to stay to one ethnicity. Dude, if it
especially
was
up here in America.
I'm trying to taste the rainbow sun. I mean,
unless it's incest.
Alabama? Dear Council Show. Rashad said that.
Hey, for some reason, we lost our live feed in Alabama.
Right?
Yeah, that's weird. It's so
you
weird.
You guys are assholes. So.
But yeah, I learn how to spell next time.
But anyway. Yeah, I mean, we're in a multi-pot.
Archie Bunker.
We're in a multi-pot. How can you not want to, you know, try something different? You know, why not?
Because we're divided, man. That's the reality.
But who divides us? That's the thing. Who divides us? Us. Yeah. We divide.
Yeah. Yeah. You know? Yeah.
Society, man.
Well, we are society.
Yeah, but that's the you thing. Know? We are society.
I mean, you know, it's just.
Well, I mean, we've been around the world, right?
Yeah, you slide.
Most of us. Most of us have been around the world.
Oh, wait, how?
Yeah.
You been around or around the
world? No, you know, around the world. Now, yeah.
Us three have been around.
Yeah, yeah. Us three.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I didn't know, you just look like the international.
I didn't know. I was hanging out with whores.
You filthy whores. Yeah. No, but, you know, like I've been to Italy. Spoiler alert, Italy is full of Italians.
Oh, they love some black
men. So, you know,
they do. I'm not joking.
You know, I've been to, you know, different countries and stuff like that where, you know, I've been to the UK, right. You know. The UK is close, but every other country I've been with, there's a huge population.
You've been with?
Well, I mean,
what? Yeah. I mean, that's it. I mean, yeah. Just giving them some away. You saw that?
A little whore.
No. I mean, every place that I've been with platonically. Platonically.
There you go.
I've been in those.
We can edit this out, right?
We'll edit this out. No, but on my Bible study trip.
Missionary trip.
Missionary trip while I was studying. But the thing is that, you know, when you're in Italy, like you're surrounded by Italian culture and stuff like that, you might get a pocket here and there of some other culture, or you go to Spain, you'll get a pocket here and there of some other culture. America, I think America is unique in that, like, there's so many different cultures that are within like driving distance, within touching distance.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
Yeah,
like
you could talk about Europe. Yeah,
you know what I mean?
A lot of neighboring countries.
Exactly, and that's why I think it is a waste to not want to experience some culture. You know what I mean? Like,
I agree, man. You know, I agree. I think every American who is in school should experience a different culture. Just go abroad. Mm-hmm. Just to have that experience.
That's why I say everybody needs to go to the military once. Well, they went to the military, they see every country and serve the country at the same time.
That's actually something I regret, not ever joining the military. Mm-hmm. Like when I was younger. Because I wanted to be a Marine. So that's why Sarge, shout out to Sergeant Davis, man. He was the one that, you know, just like pushed me towards that. Like, bro, you got to do it. And again, like it was, I regret it because I wanted to travel the world. But because, you know, I saw, like, some of the messed up cases, you know, they'd be like, nah, I'm like, it's not worth it. Yeah. And I talked to a veteran and told me it's not worth it, so.
And then also, like.
It isn't, but it is.
It's just who you ask. I think it's the better question. It depends who you ask.
Was it worth it for me? No. Would I do it again? Hell yeah.
Yeah, you've been passed around the continent.
I mean, you would get so much life lessons just experiencing another culture. You'll find out more about yourself. I mean, just speaking from experience, when I went to Mexico for the first time, it was never on vacation or anything. Like, I had to go to school there. Mm-hmm. I was the only American, only native English speaker in my classes.
Did that make Mexican women more attractive to you? After living over there?
I will say that I started paying more attention to Latina women afterwards. Because
you were surrounded by them for so long.
And I didn't really have much contact with Latina women prior to me coming to Mexico. And then going there, getting the experience that I've gained where I was getting these type of attentions from women that I've never had before in the past, that had an effect on me. Like, man, like, they're seeing something in me that women back home doesn't really see or notice it. So that stuck with me. So when I returned to the States, when I see a Latina woman, it's like, oh, man.
Yeah, I see that, yeah.
So it was just the experience.
You did notice them a lot more, yeah.
Yeah, so that was, I think that's the reason for my being, you know, towards the Latino. But that's a whole nother, you know.
But I go out on a limb right here
and
say this about me and Rashad. I know there's many a countries where we wanted to bring women back home with us.
Hold on. As I remember, wasn't there a story?
No, there was no story.
Italian story? Tell the Italian story.
There was no story.
Tell whatsoever. The Italian story, yeah? Hey, tell it.
Well, okay. All right. So it wasn't Italy.
Oh.
It was the beast of Spain.
Oh.
And I almost didn't come back.
All right.
Because... I met a young lady.
She's probably watching the show now.
So I know, right? It could have been my baby. Night. It's like, that's where my baby daddy is. Yeah. So that. So when we travel the world, we can't go to Spain.
You know,
we can't go to Spain, Italy, Greece.
You know,
God damn it,
that's crazy, man. I experienced something quite similar.
You got a baby mama?
What?
Nah. What? Now she knows where you're at. It's international.
It's crazy, man, because, like, you know, I remember, you know, going to Mexico and going to school there. It was crazy that when I first arrived in Mexico, I was in a relationship. I had a girlfriend here in the States. She was mixed, black and white. Mm-hmm. And, you know, when I was there, I was completely like, nah, I'm good. I'm, you know, I was so into this person that I was with back at home. But unfortunately, she left me for another guy because I was in Mexico. So I was heartbroken and everything.
Like, he got the Dear John letter.
Oh, I heard about that.
Oh, yeah.
But,
Dear Hakeem, it was fine.
Yeah, I know, right? Crazy thing, I was only gone for 4 months. It wasn't even that long, you know? So, yeah.
But,
that's okay. Mine happened after 1 month.
Well, that's okay. I mean, because you were gone for 4 months, but she was cheating on you for six. I think you lucked out, bro.
But so after that breakup when she left me, I enjoyed my experience a lot more.
Mm-hmm.
Not that the fact that, you know, I was dating and stuff like that, but I didn't have to worry because I was always so concerned about her. Like, what is she doing? Like, she was constantly on my mind.
Right.
But anyways, going back to what you experienced in Spain.
She was doing the whole football crew, bro.
Going back to, like, kind of like what you experienced in Spain, I meet this this Colombian chick at the university I went to in Mexico. And And this type of story, man, like, they could probably do a chick flick on this type of stuff. Like, how, you know, the way we met was in the very beginning. And the university I attended there had a fiesta for, like, the foreign exchange students. So you had your Colombians.
That a store?
No, fiesta, like a party.
Oh, yeah. That's what I meant.
Yeah. So,
shout out to fiesta.
And so, like, you're meeting all the foreign exchange students. I mean, you had people from Europe, I mean, the UK, Argentina, I mean, Brazil. I mean, it was an amazing event. And then I meet this Colombian girl, and I remember she introduced herself, and then she saw my button pin where they had the American flag, so she knew that I was American. Mm. And then she's like, oh, you're from the States? And I'm like, yeah. And she's like, oh, well, maybe you have to... teach me English sometimes. I'm like, yeah, certainly. And
teach you Dinglish.
So we end up dancing, at this event, but then we lost touch because at that time I was in a relationship, you know. Mm. And then months later, she finds me on Facebook, and I added her, and then she immediately messaged me like, oh, I've been looking for you, this and that. You know, how you been? And so from there, we started hanging out. And
that's when you got the paternity test?
Yeah. It wasn't mine. But it's crazy because, like, you know, we, it was like an adventure in the sense of, like, she wasn't from Mexico. You know, I wasn't from there.
Mm-hmm.
And we were both foreigners in another country.
Mm-hmm.
So we pretty much stuck together and just explored the city. And it was kind of like, you know, man, like, I was kind of having feelings like, dang, man, I want to bring her back type stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And so, but yeah, that was the type of experience that one may have when you.
I have a question for you guys, and I've been wanting to ask you. So, with the whole interracial thing, you know, do you guys think that, or do you believe that you're, you know, perfect example, our side, Mexicans, kids in cages. Your side is more like, you know, you guys being beat brutality.
Systematic racism?
Yeah. You know, do you think that if you're dating someone in a different ethnicity, should they stand up for you? Or is it they should or they shouldn't? Or, do you care?
100% they should stand up for you.
I think no matter what, who it is, if it's your spouse, no matter who, whether they're Mexican and you're Mexican, they're black or interracial, they should stand up for you.
Because I see, and I say this, you know, experience or people that I know, is that, again, we're seeing a lot of this with, you know, black people just left to right, they're beating them like piñatas, but no one's standing up. Same thing with us Mexicans. I see all these kids in cages. Actually, nobody's talking about it no more.
Yeah.
But nobody's standing up. And I see a lot of this interracial. No one's saying nothing. So that's what I'm saying. Should it something be said, or how do you?
Yes. I think 100% that. But I think that that's not just for you and your significant other.
Mm.
I think that's for if there's anybody. If you're a white person and you have more than one black friend, and you know what I mean, so you know when they're going through something or there's a cause that you can support, you should automatically support that,
right?
You know what I mean. So I have way too many friends and family in the Hispanic community for me not to care about immigration.
Right.
I have way too many Asian friends and family for me not to care when they're being prosecuted and hunt down on the streets.
I see that.
You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, so I think it goes beyond just relationship. I think that's just humans.
Right. Right.
You know what I mean? Yeah. What's right is right. What's wrong is wrong.
Right.
And regardless what the race may be, what the particular race is. Or whether if you're gay, straight, what's right is right, what's wrong is wrong. And if you're seeing someone that's you know being mistreated, we should definitely speak up on it. Hey man, what's your problem? Like,
What about you, Padre?
I don't know. I got this one thing. Okay, y'all know who Carli D'Amelio is?
I've heard of her.
She's famous TikTok teenage girl.
Mm-hmm.
I know she was getting flack because she was like standing up for the Black Lives Matter. She had their emblem on her Facebook page because she was wanting to use her platform to stand up for what was injustice. But so many people attacked her because she wasn't black and telling her she needed to take it down because it was only for black people only to use that. You know, and so she apologized and took it down. And she goes, I'm sorry. I didn't know it was only for black people, and I didn't mean to offend nobody, so I took it down.
I think...
Why am I getting mad?
I'm like thinking, wouldn't you want somebody famous to stand up for
you? Thank you.
Oh, my goodness. That's not even your color?
Yeah. Exactly.
That could help your race? You know what I'm saying? I would take it. Mm-hmm. You know, that with everything that's going along with the border.
Who sent that message or whatnot.
You it know, was a lot was, of people. She was attacked quite you know, a bit.
Yeah, it was like, more than one person, yeah.
Yeah,
I've never heard about but that. But damn,
yeah.
I think a lot of times it's like, okay, sure, you might be part of the group that's being affected more, but don't shit on your allies.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
If they're trying to be an ally, they're trying to help. If they do it in a way that's not helpful, then, okay, yeah, sure, hey, maybe instead of doing this, you should do this.
Mm.
Okay, cool. If they're really an ally, they'll change, no problem.
Right.
But if you're just going to shit on your ally, then all of the people that would be allies are going to be like, well, I can't stand up for Black Lives Matter because, well, I'm not black and I'm just going to get shit on.
Yeah.
No, I need you to stand up for Black Lives Matter because Black Lives Matter.
Right.
You know what I mean? So
I was gonna mess with you. I was gonna say all lives matter.
All lives matter, especially the black ones.
Well, man, this has been a great show. It has to come to an end.
Man, it's been real.
And first, I want to thank you guys for for coming out. You guys made it a hell of a show.
Yes.
Thank you for the invitation, man.
Hey, Keem, if you want people to hit you up or find you, where can they find you, man? Or give a shout out to somebody or that special lady in your life.
Just shout out to the people who's been watching. Continue to support my boy Rashad and Manny. This show is definitely picking up some momentum, and I'm just glad to be a part of it, man. And truly honored to be on the show and have these deep discussions and to be unfiltered and just to say what's on your mind. And I think it's good to have these discussions because, you know, although people see the world differently, but we can learn from one another just facts. Hearing different perspectives and to find a common ground on certain things. And I think this is a good way of doing that because, you know, we're not going to always agree on everything, you know?
Right.
But we could understand of why, you know, you think the way you do because of that, you know?
Right.
And so that's what we got to keep
you,
doing.
Man. Yeah, thank you. So do you want them to find you anywhere? Instagram, Facebook?
My Facebook is Keem Shelby. And my Instagram is Shelby Keem, so it's in reverse. So that's
send him some likes.
Send him some likes, some ads, and make new friends. What about you, Padre? Anywhere you want them to hit you up at, or any?
Junior Alfred Ramirez on Facebook.
Facebook, Instagram. You got any Instagram?
I do, but I don't remember it.
What about you, brother? Any last words?
At the end of the day, we're having these conversations because these are conversations that we need to have.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. You shouldn't be afraid. That's why we're the cancel show. We're going to get canceled so that way you don't have to.
Mm-hmm.
If you're offended by anything we say, good. You live in a free country, so you should be offended every now and then. If I haven't offended you, just wait. I'll get to you. Thank you so much to my brother. Thank you so much, El Padre. Thank you so much, Akeem.
Oh, man.
Big Dookie on the ones and twos. We appreciate you. We do realize that you do need sleep.
Yes. And I want to say thank you to everybody. Again, if you guys, after this, you know, if you have an opinion, write it down in the comments. We'll respond to them. Ian, check out our Facebook, Instagram, our Snapchat, our TikTok, our
YouTube.
Check us all out at The Cancel Show.
Yes. Anywhere podcasts are being heard, you can listen to it.
Whether you like us or not, at the end of the day, it's still an opinion. It's your right to have that opinion. And if you don't like it, change the channel. That's it. Peace.
And you said, don't be a dick.
Don't be a dick.
They say I walk like a king, talk like a king. You can act around now, say the same thing. They chasing the fame, they all want the name. But they ain't got what's running through these veins. Say I walk like a king, talk like a king. You can act around now, say the same thing. They chasing the fame, they all want the name. The thing got what's running through these veins. Make way for the king. Make way for the kingdom. King me, checkmate to repeat. This chest not checkers. What can I say? I got goat genes. Real kings do king things. Live like one, breathe like one. Killing shit by any means. Everybody can't lead like one. Nah, is it really me? Gotta check and see my legacy like royalty. And I act like it. If you know, better act like it. Look at me now. Hold me down, so give me the crown. They say I walk like a king, talk like a king. You can act around now, say the same thing. They chasing the fame, they all want the name. But they ain't got what's running through.